So that's the trees, those are the roots. This is all my inner exploration. I'm not sharing this with you. I might call a friend to explore it, but not with the person I'm engaged in the dialogue with. I'm not likely to bring it. So that's my, okay, so I'm feeling this and that, I'm meeting this and that. Okay, then I become curious. Now that I've self-connected and I'm feeling a little bit better and I'm kind of like, oh yeah, of course, I want to contribute. That's kind of like a light energy instead of a, God, I'm really bad at this energy. So I bring that light energy, and from that light energy, I can say, whoa, what might be going on for them? Like, why would they respond that way? That seems really strange to me. I don't understand that. And that still might be my internal exploration. What might they be feeling and needing? Well, maybe they're disappointed because they really want a sense of trust that I'm doing the best job I can. Maybe they just need some trust that it's going to be, that everyone's needs are going to get met in this process. Okay, so now I've explored that internally. And now we can move up the tree, out of the silent roots of the tree, and ask ourselves, what do we want to do next? And in nonviolent communication, after that, there's kind of two choices. There's a choice for empathy, or helping the other person become more self-aware without judgment, which would be asking them, what are you feeling and needing? And I like to say there's more to just the asking of what are you feeling and needing. There's a quality of presence I now am going to bring. I'm really present. So that there's that connection being built, which meets a whole bunch of needs, just that. Needs for trust, needs for connection, needs for knowing that you matter, if I'm really present. So I'm just bringing that quality presence. I'm really trying to hear. And then the second piece of it I like to think about, and again, I've thought about this myself, and also John Kenyon was another trainer I've worked with who talked about these particular steps, and I really enjoy him, so I want to acknowledge him and his appreciate his framework. So after the quality of presence, then I like to just be able to reflect it back. And this we also have in our collaborative law training in interspace mediation. Just saying back whatever it is you're saying. Is in your words potentially, because often that's then you're really knowing I'm present with you, and that contributes to your sense of being gotten and understood. And even that's empathic. Even that will give you a sense of, ah, they get me. And then that just starts to calm the energy. Then the next step is really kind of becoming curious and exploring what it is that you're needing. And in nonviolent communication, the way we do that is we make it a guess. Are you feeling upset because you need respect? And I like to say that you could, a lot of times people get triggered, don't give me that touchy-feely stuff. I don't want to go with my feelings. But you could just say, so is it that you just want some respect? And just that is what really lands it for people, because the feelings can be overwhelming and they're not as necessary to connect to as the needs. Because what I find is, as soon as I name the need, and I'm guessing, and the reason I'm guessing is because I actually don't know. It may not be respect for you, and that's okay. And you'll tell me, no, it's not about respect, I want to be understood. Which to me seems similar, but to them may not. But they've now named the need, they've honed in on it themselves, when before they were totally in story. Right? They're just talking about what's happening, they're not really self-connected at all. But as soon as I name a guess of a need, it brings them to guess, to name a need, even if it's not the, even if the one I named wasn't the right one. But as soon as you get the right one, you can see them just sink. You can like physically see the energy go from kind of frantic up here to, and there's a way in which it's really grounding. And then from there, there's a sense of, okay, now they become curious. Now they become curious if I'm in a conflict with them, or if they're in a conflict with their spouse in a collaborative law setting. Now they become curious about what's going on for the other person. The other beautiful thing about it is these needs are universal needs. We all have these needs, regardless of who we are or where we live or how much money we have or our gender or our race or our age. We all share these same needs. So if you say you have a need for respect, guess what? So do I. And now I can get why you're upset. Maybe you misunderstood my intentions. It wasn't that I intended to not respect you, but I can understand that for you it wasn't respectful and that that's an important thing to you. And now I may be like, can you tell me what would have been a respectful way to say this? What would have been respectful to you? Because I thought I was being respectful, but I get for you it wasn't. And so it opens a door for problem solving. And I don't like to rush us there, but in the context of the collaborative practice or in the context of the legal setting, ultimately there is a goal that we're trying to get to, which is resolution. And so I want to slow it down enough to connect people and keep them self-aware without judgment and aware of each other's needs without judgment, so we can now move forward to find solutions. And the beautiful thing is that when we move off the positional strategy debate fight and move to the needs-based fight, then we find a zillion other possibilities available to us. And it opens up an abundance of the strategies for us. And the limits then for problem solving is simply our own creativity. And I like at that point to say, wow, if you and I can't find the creative solution, wow, then we sit here with the realization that we can't find a solution right now. But we're still in connection. There's no longer a conflict or a dilemma between us now, instead of the dilemma being a ball between us that we're fighting against. It's like a ball we're bouncing around. Who else can bounce this ball with us and help us find the solution to this problem? Are there other people we think might know this? Maybe a counselor would have some information for us. Maybe another family member. Maybe we just need to bring in 5 or 6 friends. Maybe we can invite the lawyers to help us problem solve. But we're in a much more expansive, visionary, creative space than in the you're right, I'm wrong, I'm right, you're wrong dilemma of pushing against each other. Now, instead, we're like building, creating. It's like taking blocks and building it bigger, and building it out. And for me, that's what's so powerful about it and what makes it so beautiful. There's an abundance of possibilities and resources rather than a scarcity. And I think when we look at the world in scarcity, we get scared because we don't trust our needs will get met. And then we go into self-protection. But when we realize, oh, there's a bunch of strategies that can meet our needs, then we're not in a scarcity mode anymore. We're not afraid. And so we can be really creative. So the other piece about this that is really important, when we talk about the needs being universal, they're not connected to person, place, or time. And so what's so powerful about that is, if I want connection, if I'm attached to having connection with you, and you actually don't really want connection with me, then I'm kind of alone. My need for connection, if I believe you're the only person who can meet my needs, then my need for connection will go unmet, and I'm powerless. I'm really in a place of powerlessness. I'm just gonna wait for you to turn around and change your life around to meet my needs for connection. Okay, so now you have all the power, I'm powerless, and boy, I feel pretty depleted and sad and lonely. But if I realize that I don't need connection with you, and I can think about all the other ways in my life my needs for connection are met, then I feel really empowered. And it's really empowering. So a really great example of this, but just like so primordial, is so when my children were born, you know, I'm really glad I'm still in their lives. But if, God forbid, I had died in birth, let's say, I'd like to believe that all my children's needs would have been met. Their needs for love, nurturance, touch, connection, meaning, growth, play, fun. I'd like to think that I meet those needs for my children in a particularly delicious way, and that they cherish me as their mom, and they do. But those needs, it would be devastating for me to imagine them not having those needs met in their life. So I trust that those needs would have been met in their lives even if I wasn't in their lives. And that's a beautiful thing, because then we can imagine with all the people on this planet, including ourselves, there's an abundance of ways to get my needs met. It's not just my former husband has to do this or else, or my child has to do this or else, or my sister has to do this or else. Oh, I can get these needs met in an abundance of ways. And when we have that, then when you don't meet my needs, it's not such a big deal. I might grieve it, I might be sad, I might be bummed, because boy, that would have been really sweet for me. I really enjoyed connecting with you and I would really enjoy doing some more of it. But I can also enjoy it with the 20 other friends in my life who bring meaning and joy to my life.